هذا القرآن يوحدنا لطريق الخير يوجهنا، الله تعالى أنزله ورسول الله معلمنا، ورسول الله معلمنا.
الرحمن الرحيم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. أما بعد، my dear brothers and sisters, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. We continue our tafsir class tonight, bidhnillahi ta'ala, with the tafsir of Surah Al-Qadr. Surah Al-Qadr, let us understand the title of this surah. Al-Qadr over here has one of two possible meanings. The first meaning of Al-Qadr in this surah is that it is a night of power and a night of magnificence and a night of greatness. And that is the first meaning of Al-Qadr over here. So when you say someone is ذو قدرٍ, it means he is someone of prestige, someone of honor, someone of might. The second meaning of Qadr in the surah is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is referring to divine decree. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decrees something, this is known as the Qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as you'll come to see in the surah bi'idhnillahi ta'ala, this is actually one of the nights where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala dictates the decree of the following year. So that is the title of the surah. In terms of the reason of revelation of this surah, there is no exact specific reason of revelation, but it is mentioned that this surah was sent down for two main purposes. Number one was to mention how the Qur'an was actually revealed. The first reason was to mention how the Qur'an was actually revealed. And then number two was to create a distinction between those that loved the Qur'an and those that hated the Qur'an. So as you can see, when the Qur'an was sent down to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam amongst the Quraysh, the believers loved the revelation. Because for them it was divine guidance and it was ultimate guidance, and this was something that they wanted to stick on to. Whereas for the Quraysh, this was something that came to destroy their lifestyle. It came to destroy their polytheism. It came to destroy the power that they had. And that is why this is something that they hated. So the second reason why the surah was revealed was to create that distinction between the believers and the disbelievers. So now let us get into the very first verse. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He tells us, إِنَّا أَنزَلْنَاهُ فِي لَيْلَةِ الْقَدْرِ, that indeed we have sent it down on the night of Al-Qadr. It over here is clearly referring to the Qur'an. And the reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't mention the term Qur'an over here, but rather refers to it in the third person, is because how well it was known already. That there was no dispute as to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was referring to. And you'll notice that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only uses the third person when it is understood what He is referring to. So sometimes we may refer to the third person to remain ambiguous. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses the third person, He uses it because there's absolute no doubt about it. So the who over here, إِنَّا أَنزَلْنَاهُ, refers to the Qur'an, فِي لَيْلَةِ الْقَدْرِ. Now, as for Laylatul Qadr over here, this is where we're going to get into some basic theology, bi'idhnillahi ta'ala. Firstly, let us talk about the revelation of the Qur'an. Let us talk about the revelation of the Qur'an. Let me just put the bookmark here so we can fix the page, inshallah, when I need to get back to it. So in terms of the revelation of the Qur'an, when revelation came down to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, revelation did not come down directly from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So let us understand that. In Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He tells us that شهر رمضان, that it is the month of Ramadan in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down the Qur'an. So now when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the sending down of the Qur'an in this verse, it is the very first revelation that is coming from Jibreel to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So that first revelation came down to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the month of Ramadan. Now, however, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about in Surah Al-Qadr that we have sent down the Qur'an in the night of Laylatul Qadr or the night of Al-Qadr, it is referring to how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala transferred the Qur'an from Al-Lawh Al-Mahfuz to Sama' Al-Dunya. Let us understand these terms. Lawh Al-Mahfuz, this is where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has written down divine decree. So in Sahih Muslim, you find the hadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, 50,000 years before the creation and of the heavens and the earth, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told the pen to write. And the pen said, what shall I write? And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told the pen, write everything that shall take place from now until the end of time. From now until the end of time. So this is what the Lawh al-Mahfuz is. That the Lawh al-Mahfuz is this divine tablet where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has written everything down from the beginning of time till the end of time. Now when the Qur'an is being revealed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not speak the Qur'an directly to Jibreel. What happened over here is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the Qur'an to the Lawh al-Mahfuz, had it written down in the Lawh al-Mahfuz, and then this Qur'an was taken from the Lawh al-Mahfuz to the lowest of the heavens. To the lowest of the heavens. And this is when Jibreel would come by the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and recite parts of it to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the first revelation that came down was in the month of Ramadan. But that's not what this verse is referring to. This verse is referring to the transferring of the Qur'an from Lawh al-Mahfuz to the lowest of the heavens. And this is what Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhum mentions in the tafsir of At-Tabari. It is mentioned in the tafsir of At-Tabari that this is how the revelation of the Qur'an began. It was taken from Lawh al-Mahfuz to the lowest of the heavens. And this is also the opinion of Ikrimah and the opinion of Sa'id ibn Jubair. Now, another interesting thing to note about this verse is another theological aspect, understanding divine decree. So firstly, let us understand, as a Muslim, what is compulsory upon us in terms of believing in Qadr. So you notice in the hadith of Jibreel, that Jibreel comes to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he asks him, أخبرني عن الإيمان, tell me about Iman. And then the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam goes on to mention the six articles of faith. Who can quickly give me what the six articles of faith are? Arkanul Iman, compulsory upon every Muslim. What are they? Go ahead.
Believe in Allah.
Excellent.
And the angels.
Uh-huh.
And the books and the messengers.
Uh-huh.
And the last day.
Uh-huh.
To believe in Al-Qadr, it's good and bad.
Excellent. So he asked the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, أخبرني عن الإيمان, tell me about Iman. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam responds by saying that Iman is to believe in the following six things. It is to believe in Allah, it is to believe in the angels, it is to believe in the books, it is to believe in the last day, and it is to believe in the angels. Did I mention angels?
Yeah,
prophets. The prophets. And it is to believe in the qadr, the good of it, and the bad of it. So now, this last part, the qadr, good of it and bad of it, what is pertinent to us? What are we required to believe? The aqidah of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah pertaining to qadr consists of four things. So our belief as Sunni Muslims consists of four things when it comes to qadr. Element number one is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows everything. That nothing escapes the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So future, past, present, if things were to change in time, even Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would know how that would happen. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's knowledge is completely encompassing of everything. Number two is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had qadr written down 50,000 years before the creation of the heavens and the earth. So everything that is meant to happen was written down 50,000 years before it actually took place. And this is actually amazing, subhanAllah, that here we are tonight talking about Qadr, and this very event was documented not 50,000 years ago from now, but 50,000 years prior to the creation of the heavens and the earth. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala dictated and wrote down that each and every one of you right now would be in this very musalla listening to this very lecture on Qadr, subhanAllah. Now that's mind-boggling. Number three is that nothing happens except by the permission and will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nothing happens except by the will and permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then number four, and this is like a tricky one to understand, we'll get to it eventually, is that even all of the actions of creation are created. So any actions that we do as human beings, even those actions that we do are created. So for example, an individual, a husband and wife get together and they produce a child. So now this child, even though it wasn't directly produced by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't mold it with his own hands, or the angels didn't mold it through the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but rather it was molded through a husband and wife getting together. We still say that this child is the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even though it wasn't directly created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it means that even the actions of the creation are a creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now when does Qadr actually get written down? When does Qadr actually get written down, and can Qadr change? So there's one type of Qadr that definitely does not change, and that is the Qadr that is written in Lawhul Mahfuz. So anything that is written down in Lawhul Mahfuz will never ever change. That is the way it was meant to be, and that is what will happen. Now the knowledge of Lawhul Mahfuz is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what is in Lawhul Mahfuz. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells the angels what is pertinent. That is the qadr that never changes. Now, what about the qadr that does change? So you find in an authentic hadith that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says that nothing changes qadr like dua. Nothing changes qadr like dua. And another hadith related to this one is that nothing elongates one's lifespan like keeping good ties with one's family, silatul rahim. That nothing elongates one's lifespan like silatul rahim. And there's an addition to this hadith where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best if it is authentic or not, but nothing decreases one's sustenance, nothing decreases one's risk like ithm, like sin. So your sin will be a cause of a decrease in your sustenance. So now here Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam clearly tells us that qadr does change. Now what is this qadr that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam is referring to? So the qadr that changes is of three types that is mentioned in the Qur'an. It is of three types that is mentioned in the Qur'an and the Sunnah. So the first type of qadr that is written for an individual is when he comes into this world. So you have the famous hadith known as the hadith of As-Sadiq al-Masduq, that Abdullah bin Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, he says, I heard from As-Sadiq al-Masduq, that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the most trustworthy of all of those that are trustworthy, referring to the Messenger of Allah. And this hadith mentions that when a child is born, four types of qadr are written for him. Does anyone know what those four types of qadr are? It is mentioned in Imam Nawawi's 40 hadith. Go ahead.
Believer, disbeliever.
Not directly in those words.
Be happier side.
Okay, happier side is one of them.
The risk.
Risk, excellent.
Where he will die.
Death.
Where he will die, ajluhu, excellent. So his death will be written. And then what did you mention, Uthman? His age? No, not age. No, that's what happy or sad is referring to. There's one last one. I've mentioned it already. We talked about sin. What does sin do? Decreases one's risk. So his risk is written for him. So in this hadith of As-Sadiq al-Masduq, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentions that four kalimat, four things are written down for this newborn. Number one, his risk. His sustenance is written down for him at that time. How much he will earn, how much he will get, all of that is written down at that time. Number two, when he will die, where he will die. Ajluhu, it is written down at that time. Amaluhu, his actions that he will do. So whether he will be a believer or a disbeliever, good actions, bad actions, that's written down at that time. And then the last thing, is he shaqi or sa'id? And shaqi or sa'id, is he someone who is fortunate or someone who has misfortune written down for him? So this is the first type of qadr that is written down that is changeable, that is changeable. The second type of qadr that is written down is the qadr that is mentioned in Surah Al-Qadr. So again, you have from Al-Hasan Al-Basri and Sayyid ibn Jubair, they said that this night is called Laylatul Qadr because this is the night that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala dictates to the angels what their responsibilities are for the following year. That these are the responsibilities of the angels for the following year. So the second type of qadr is the qadr that takes place on Laylatul Qadr itself. Number three, and this is the last type of qadr that is mentioned, this is in Surah Ar-Rahman, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, كُلَّ يَوْمٍ هُوَ فِي شَأْنٍ, that every day Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is busy with an affair, is doing something. The scholars of tafsir mentioned that this is the qadr that is written down on a daily basis. Now these three last types of qadr are the types of qadr that are interchangeable. So when an individual has something decreed for him, but then he makes dua, then all of a sudden that destiny changes. When an individual commits sin, it decreases his risk, that changes from his changeable qadr. And then likewise, an individual keeps good ties with his family, this is a means of his life being elongated, so the angels are told to elongate his life. So these are the qadr, types of qadr that are interchangeable. These are the types of qadr that are interchangeable. So now you see the magnificence of this night. That on this night, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not only did He choose it to transfer the Qur'an from Lawh al-Mahfuz to Sama' al-Dunya, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also makes this night the night where your qadr is written down for the following year. Meaning that your, you know, great events that will happen for the following year are written down on that night. So that is the very first verse. And let us go into this right now. Defining Laylatul Qadr. When is Laylatul Qadr? And then number two, does Laylatul Qadr take place on the same night every single night? So the first discussion we'll have is that reconciling the different narrations. Reconciling the different narrations. So, in terms of narrations from the Sahaba, you have from Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, he narrated the 23rd and the 27th. Some of the other Sahaba, they said it was the 21st. And then you will have very few narrations that mention the 29th. Now what do we actually find from the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself? You'll find three general narrations that mention that look for Laylatul Qadr in the last 10 nights of Ramadan. Then in addition to this one, look for Laylatul Qadr in the odd last 10 nights of Ramadan. And in another hadith, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, and if you're not able to in the last 10 nights, then look for it in the last 7 nights. Then with all of these narrations, how does a person reconcile this great event that is of the utmost concern to every believer? So the scholars of tafsir and of aqidah, they discuss this issue. And the first conclusion they come to is that Laylatul Qadr in fact changes every year. And that is why you have so many different narrations that Laylatul Qadr will fall on different nights, because each year it was on a different night. Now what is the purpose behind having it on a different night? Number one is so that Muslims don't become lazy. Imagine if the Muslims knew when Laylatul Qadr was, they would only show up to the masjid on Laylatul Qadr. Because Laylatul Qadr is like worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for more than 83 years and 4 months. 83 years, Al-Fushara is coming up, 83 years and 4 months. They're like, Allah, so we never need to come to the masjid ever again. So it prevents that laziness. And then number two, it is just a way of increasing the believer's reward. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keeps it hidden, it is an opportunity for us to increase our reward. And that is why Laylatul Qadr should be sought in the last 10 nights, and not just in the odd last 10 nights. Because the scholars of hadith, they mention over here that it is very possible that when the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that seek for it in the odd last 10 nights, he was being specific for that year. But when he said generally that seek it in the last 10 nights, then this is general that every year it will fall within the last 10 nights. Now, what's interesting over here is how did Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma come to the conclusion that it was the 27th night? This is very, very interesting. There's a discrepancy in the chain of narration, but for the sake of benefit, we're going to share it anyways. So the books of tafsir mention two ways that he came to this conclusion. Conclusion number one is that he said, how many letters are there in Laylatul Qadr? So for those of you who know Arabic, count the letters in Laylatul Qadr. How many letters do you get? Laylatul Qadr, how many letters do you get? 9. Excellent. Now, for those of you who know Suratul Qadr, how many times does Laylatul Qadr, how many times is Laylatul Qadr mentioned in Suratul Qadr? 3 times. Excellent. So he said 9 times 3, this gives you 27. So Laylatul Qadr has 9 letters, and Laylatul Qadr is mentioned 3 times in the surah, so it is on the 27th night. This is one way that is mentioned. Number 2, he says that if you count the words inside Suratul Qadr, how many words do you get? Actually, this is going to be a bit difficult. I'm not going to tell you to do it. But Surat Al-Qadr, it has 30 words in it. 30 words in it. And the one that is the most indicative of when Laylatul Qadr is here. That it is, you know, Layla is feminine, right? So the feminine word for the object, here, is used as which word? The 27th word. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala affirmed here on the 27th word, indicating the 27th night. Now this chain of narration has discrepancies, but it's interesting to see what the scholars have been transmitting. They said this is why Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhumah narrated in one of his two opinions that it was the 27th night. Now let us move on to the second verse. Where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, وَمَا أَدَرَاكَ مَا لَيْلَةُ الْقَدْرِ. So you've seen this sequence in other places in the Qur'an when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asks, وَمَا أَدَرَاكَ, what will make you know? And this sequence is mentioned to bring the attention of the individual reading or listening that look, something great is about to be told to you, or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is referring to a great event, so pay very, very close attention to it. Now, following this verse, this is when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us that great news, that Laylatul Qadri khayrun min alfi shahr, that this night of decree, this night of Al-Qadr, is better than 1,000 months. So he didn't say equal to, but he said it is better than 1,000 months. And that comes down to 83 years and 4 months. So number one, the first thing we want to draw your attention to is that the average individual, he will only live for approximately that long. That if he's fortunate enough with life, he may live to be that long. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us that throughout the year, there is one night that if you were to catch ibadah on that night, it would be better than the ibadah of a whole lifetime. 83 years and 4 months. Number two, some of the scholars mention another reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions this is because in comparison to the people of the past, our lifespans are actually much, much shorter. Can anyone think of an example in the Qur'an of a prophet that had a very long lifespan? How long did he live? 950 years. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He mentions in the Qur'an that he lived for 950 years. So they mention that the previous nations had this great opportunity to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through these long number of years, and this was not something given to the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala replaced that long lifespan with the night of Laylatul Qadr. That in this one night, it is better than 1,000 months. And you can imagine that if you were to catch it for something like, let's just say, 50 years, right? 50 years in a row, bi-idhni Allah ta'ala, you're in the masjid for the last 10 nights of Ramadan, so that's 50 years times 80 years, that's like 4,000 years of ibadah. That's 4,000 years of ibadah you potentially could catch if you caught Laylatul Qadr for 50 years. So it shows you the favor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now a third reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions Alf Shahr over here is because in the Arabic language, the meaning of Alf can actually have two meanings. One is the literal meaning that 1,000 months. So if you tell someone, أُصَاحِبُكَ لِأَلْفِ شَهْرٍ, that I will accompany you for 1,000 months. For someone that just looks at this literally, he thinks that I'm going to be your companion or your friend on a contractual basis for 1,000 months. Then 1,000 months, once it's over, I will no longer be your friend. But the Arabs of old did not understand 1,000 months as this. They understood as 1,000 months as an eternity. That as long as we're alive, as long as there is existence, I will continue to be your friend. So now, it is mentioned over here that Al-Fashahr is mentioned that catching ibadah on one night over here is the equivalent of our understanding of infinity. That as human beings, our understanding is very limited, but as far as our mind can understand, that it is like worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala till the end of time itself. And that is why 1,000 is mentioned over here, خَيْرٌ مِنْ أَلْفِ شَهْرٍ. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala goes on to describe to us what actually takes place on this night. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala goes on to mention in the next verse, تَنَزَّلُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ وَالرُّوحُ فِيهَا بِإِذْنِ رَبِّهِمْ مِنْ كُلِّ أَمْرٍ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala goes on to mention that it is on this night that the angels and the ruh descend by the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala مِنْ كُلِّ أَمْرٍ. And we'll get to that in a second. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He mentions the descent of the angels. So now when the descent of the angels is mentioned in the Qur'an, the angels come down to fill the spaces with goodness, to fill it with blessing. And that is why if you look in the authentic hadith, that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentions that no group of people gather in one of the houses of Allah except that the angels descend upon them and encompass them with their wings and seek forgiveness for them and bring down mercy with them. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the angels being sent down, this is what it is referring to. That night, it is a night filled with barakah. And you'll notice over here that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions tanazzalu. Tanazzalu actually comes from another verb, tatanazzalu. So tatanazzalu, it means that they come down in a great abundance over a consistent period of time. Whereas tanazzalu, it means that they come down in a great number, but only once. So now if you look in Surah Al-Fussilat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He tells us, using the same verb, تَتَنَزَّلُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ, the angels come down, and when the believer is dying, they tell him, لَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ, that there's no fear upon you, and you have nothing to fear, nothing to fear, and we are your companions. And this is every time a believer dies. So every couple of minutes there's someone, you know, a believer dying, or even every couple of seconds there's someone dying. And that's why tatanazzalu is used at that time, because it is regular throughout time that they will come down. Yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this verse, He only used tanazzalu, which means that they come down in plethora, in great numbers, but it is only once a year. And that is due to the night of Al-Qadr. That is due to the night of Al-Qadr and the barakah that there is therein. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses the term tanazzalu al-mala'ikatu wal-ruhu. So the angels descend down and ar-ruh. In the Quran, generally speaking, when ar-ruh is mentioned, it is referring to one specific angel. Which angel is that? Jibril. Now by consensus in this verse, ar-ruh is referring to Jibril. So why is it that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions something general and then something specific? So even though Jibril is from the angels, why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mention angels and then Jibril? And this is two reasons again. Number one was to show the greatness of Jibril over the other angels. So Jibril is superior over the other angels. And then number two is the direct connection of Jibril with revelation. That Jibril is the angel of revelation, and that is why he's mentioned in the surah. So this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions angels, general, and then he mentions ar-ruh, which is referring to Jibril, which is specific, because of these two reasons. The superiority of Jibril over the other angels. Then number two, the role of Jibril with revelation. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala goes on, بِإِذْنِ رَبِّهِمْ مِنْ كُلِّ أَمْرٍ. Meaning that these angels, they only come down with the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So even this creation, as great as the angels, as great as Jibril is, they're unable to move, they're unable to function, except by the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this shows you, again, the, I guess, obedience of the angels as well. Then in Surah Al-Tahrim, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions how the angels are unable to disobey Allah. يَفْعَلُونَ مَا يُؤْمَرُونَ. That they don't disobey Allah, but rather they obey every commandment that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives them. So here, until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives them permission to come down on Laylatul Qadr, then they will not come down, except by the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala concludes this verse by saying, بِإِذْنِ رَبِّهِمْ مِنْ كُلِّ أَمْرٍ, with every single command. So the command that is being referred to over here is the command of Al-Qadr. That the angels are given the commands, are given their responsibility. What are they meant to do for the next year? They're given on that night so that they fulfill their responsibilities for the next year. There is a narration from Mujahid as well, that min kulli amr over here means that the angels are sent down to this dunya, and every time they find someone worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on that night, they continue to send salam upon that individual as long as he is worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is what ties it into the next verse, is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, سَلَامٌ هِيَ حَتَّى مُطْلَعِ الْفَجْرِ, that there is peace until the appearance of dawn. So they said that the angels will continue to send peace and blessings upon those that worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala until the dawn comes apparent, meaning that up until Salatul Fajr kicks in, and it will continue to be peace. Now the scholars use this verse as one of the proofs or one of the ways of finding Laylatul Qadr. So what is one of the ways that you find Laylatul Qadr? Is that it is a night that is filled with peace. Another proof that they mention in terms of finding Laylatul Qadr is that the rays of the sun will not be harmful on that day. Meaning that you'll directly be able to look into the sun. And that it will be a clear, absolute clear morning. These are the authentic narrations that are mentioned in terms of how to spot Laylatul Qadr. Now what is interesting is that all of these events are after the night of, you know, is over. So you'll only know once the night is over. So after you worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the whole night, you look for the sun in terms of its rising to know if it was the correct night or not. And again, just so that Muslims don't become lackadaisical, that they only find out thereafter. And that, in brief summary, is the tafsir of Surah Al-Qadr. And we will conclude with that, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, wa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wa barak ala nabiyyina Muhammad, wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. We'll open up the floor for Q&A, and then I have a couple of announcements, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. So let's take three questions, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. Go ahead, number one. Does Jibreel come back according to this verse? Clearly he does. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions تنزل الملائكة والروح. So the angels and Jibreel come down. In terms of is any more revelation coming down, then obviously there's no more revelation coming down, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. Go ahead.
It is said that in a hadith that Jibreel in, at the night of Miraj, he went till Sidratul Muntaha.
Yes.
And here it says that he went till the first heaven. So
this is in terms of the revelation of the Qur'an. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave Jibreel the Qur'an from al-Lawh al-Mahfuz, He brought it down to the lowest heavens. And then when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would tell Jibreel that go and reveal this to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he would take this from the lowest heavens to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He wouldn't go back to al-Lawh al-Mahfuz, or he wouldn't go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
He would take it from Lawh
al-Mahfuz
and keep it at the lowest heaven and then take it
to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi
wasallam. So I just want to know, like, where is Lawh al-Mahfuz and
where is Lawh al-Mahfuz?
No, I mean to say, like, is the heaven Sidratul Muntaha a part of heaven, or
Sidratul Muntaha is from the highest of the heavens. Oh. So after the seventh heaven, that is where Sidratul Muntaha is, at the seventh heaven. Oh. Make sense? Last question. Go ahead.
In hadith, you said risk is done. It has been written. In the hadith, you said sins decrease risk.
Right. Excellent. So in terms of the second hadith that sins actually decrease one's risk, I said that there's ikhtilaf amongst the muhaddithin, is this ziyada authentic or not? So I said in the connection that we accept that it is authentic or not, then the way that we make jam' is that the risk that does not change is the risk that is written in Allah al-Mahfuz. That is the risk that will never change. However, the risk that is written down when a person is born, the risk that is written down on the night of Al-Qadr, the risk that is written down every day, then this risk will depend upon how you are as an individual. The more righteous a person is, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, the more his sustenance will be, and the more sinful a person is, then the lesser amount his sustenance will be. Now the obvious question is here, that if it is exactly as I'm saying, how is it possible for a kafir to have more wealth than a believer? That would be the obvious question. Over here when we talk about sustenance, it is about understanding one simple concept. That when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about risk, this is different from mal. Risk is different from mal. Risk is the sustenance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, provisions that Allah gives you that bring you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when you want to see how much risk a person has been given, it is how much they spend it in the way of Allah and what they do with it. And that is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says in the Qur'an, وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ, that from that which we have provided them of sustenance, they give in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yet seldom in the Qur'an will you see the same usage for mal. That mal is used in a different context. It has positive and negative connotations. Whereas rizq will only have a positive connotation, because this is something that brings an individual closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I hope that makes sense, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. Barakallahu fiqh.
Just adding clarification. So rizq is more than mal.
Clearly, sustenance. Mal is something very specific, whereas risk is sustenance, anything that, you know, gives you a life. Wallahu ta'ala alam. Sure.
Can I ask,
Go ahead,
yeah, Insham. I heard that also one of the indications that of Laylatul Qadr is that it's a quiet night. There will be no sounds of even animals or anything.
I don't think that's true. I mean, it's a quiet night that there's tranquility in it. But in terms of there's no sounds of animals, cats will continue to meow, dogs will continue to bark. Allah knows best. I've never heard that before. Go ahead.
So, Sheikh, when you said mal, do you mean money?
Yeah, so mal can fall under both concepts. So mal is considered wealth as well, but it's also considered sustenance. So in terms of that which is pure, that is called rizq. But that which can be pure or impure, then that is referred to as mal. And mal again is not only just money, but it can refer to gold and silver, anything that is used to barter, anything that is used that it is considered of monetary value would fall under mal. Wallahu ta'ala alam. So we'll conclude with that bithnahi ta'ala.